Hi together and welcome to our webinar hosted by the Open Telekom Cloud community. Today we have a guest here. It's Daniel Schellhase. It's a product manager from us, the Open Telekom Cloud, and he will say today something about the backup basics and also put a big focus at the cloud backup and recovery service.
Thank you very much, Stefan. So now it's my turn. Today, I would like to give you an introduction to backup basics. So what we will do is I would like to talk with you about different backup technologies, when they should be used, what are the pros and cons, so advantages, disadvantages of those, when to use these. And afterwards, I would like to shortly go into the service cloud backup and recovery, which we have on the Open Telekom Cloud, and give you an overview about the existing backup services which we have and what is the difference, what is the strengths and weaknesses of those. So let me first now start with a rough introduction. First of all, I would like to say two words to data in general. And here I have statistics from Statista, which show us that, of course, the volume, and I think this is not surprising, that the volume of information and data which is created, captured, copied, consumed, of course, is growing year by year. And you see that it's extremely growing year by year. And what do we do with all this data which is captured, consumed? And there's one big buzzword which we see maybe in a lot of media which is discussed a lot of times is, of course, artificial intelligence, AI. And in order to create an artificial intelligence, of course, you need to capture a lot of data. And I don't want to really talk about in-depth about how an AI works, but what I would like to say is that if you would like to know how this really works, is I would like to make a comparison about how we as a human are doing that. And this is, of course, by experience, by knowledge, by learning. So this is how an AI even works. So you need to have a lot of data, and then you need to learn and analyze these data. Of course, there's much more behind the scenes when we talk about AI in depth. But I would just like to say to you that I would like to say, like, we as humans, we are even growing. So when birth is given to us, of course, we even need to learn how to run, how to speak. Everything is just learning by experience and by collecting, of course, data. And what do we do with all the data? Is, of course, creating maybe an artificial intelligence. But of course, the question is, how do we protect these data? And here we come to possible data threats. So and threats for data and data sources. And I would like to, of course, this is not an overview which says it's covering everything which could happen to data, but it should give you an overview about what are the potential threats to data. And on the one hand, we have here user. Well, software related, so everything which is on the application layer, where someone is operating the data or maybe deleting data, where a user or software is interacting with data and documents, which is more or less the logical storage. And on the other hand, we have the hardware, where of course the hardware can get damage or failure. So you see here on the one hand, it could be a natural disaster, like for example, flood, earthquake, lightning strike, or fire. This could happen to hardware. Or ordinary hardware lifecycle, where heat or humidity has an impact on the life cycle, and of course, how long you can use a hardware device or a storage device then. And of course, when it comes to user software, of course, we read it sometimes in media that maybe a user deleted data or deleted get compromised because maybe someone fired an employee or the IT admin. This even is something which we sometimes read in the media, but even the software can, of course, be the reason of an issue with the logical storage, where of course here as well it could be an accident by implementing an update, etc. Or of course everything like ransomware, virus, Trojan, which can even have, modify data, encrypt data, all these items which can happen to the logical storage layer. And if we would like to handle these threats and how to handle these threats, is something which I would like to cover with you. And here I just put up some buzzwords like snapshots, like backup, like replication, which you might be aware of, where we from the OTC point of view have functionality in place. Like for example, for snapshots, we have the EVS snapshots. For backup, we have CSBS, PBS, and CBR. And for replication, we have the SDRS service, for example, which brings us some protection for specific threats. And I would like to talk with you about exactly Z-generic technologies, how they exactly work, what are they are protecting for. And so let's directly go to the first topic, and that is snapshots. And for snapshots, of course, we would like to give an introduction how snapshots work. So if data is created and you make a snapshot, of course, there's a restore point created, which means that you can restore to that specific point in time your data. And if you add new data and then once again click on the snapshot, for example, then of course the journal notifies what has been added, changed, deleted, modified to that data set. And of course, then you have a second restore point. And if you add new data to the storage system and of course and click next time on snapshot, then of course the journal is once again making notes about what is added and done to the data, and a third restore point is made in time. And you of course can then restore the data to that three restore points. So that's, I think, the basic technology about snapshots. The major challenge with snapshot is, or the issue which snapshot has, is of course if data gets destroyed, corrupted, then of course a restore might not be possible, depending of course when it occurs. But if, for example, here in that scenario, the first data layer is destroyed, damaged, then of course it will be it's not possible to restore. That's the disadvantage with snapshots. So what does snapshots protect for? So if we look at the overview which we had, then snapshot is normally used in order to protect for accidental deletion, deliberate deletion of data made be caused by the user or by the software itself. So that's normally the protection of snapshots. It does not provide proper protection against ransomware and virus or other Trojan horses or something like this. So because when the disks are compromised, then of course the snapshots which are stored on the same disk might be compromised as well. So of course this depends of course on the logic implemented into the virus ransomware, but normally this happens. So it does not protect really and does not provide proper protection against those kind of issues. And of course as well, it does not protect against any hardware failures. As we have seen, if hardware fails, then of course even the snapshot which is stored on the same disk will fail. Therefore, it does not protect against those kind of issues. And then you will ask me, of course, Daniel, what is it used for? And here, of course, I have a short overview for you. So first of all, snapshots are fast and efficient because you can instant do a snapshot and then, of course, you can nearly instant recover it. So that's what it is for. So it protects against user and most software-related issues. The disadvantage is, of course, the more snapshots are taken, the more resources are necessary for recovery, because you can consider that this journal could become very, very huge in time if you use it again and again and again and again. So therefore, it could take more time the more snapshots you're taking. So it does not protect, as already mentioned, against hardware failure, and it does not provide proper protection against all these kind of attacks like ransomware, virus, etc. So when should it be used? So snapshots should be made in order to retain data for a couple of days. And of course, we talk here about short-term data protection between 3 to 5 days. That's where it should be used for, but not really for long-term, because you see, as already mentioned, the longer you're using, the slower it will become. That's for snapshots. Let's get to the next topic, and that's replication. So what replication is? And replication is even very simple. So we have a set of data, and of course replication means we are copying these data to another storage location. And this of course happens if we of course add new data or even add newest data. So there's always a replication made. What we should differentiate is a direct sync, which means a direct replication, which is done most often for mission critical data where no service outage is acceptable. So for example, here from the OTC point of view, we have the SDRS service, the Storage Disaster Recovery Service, which provides exact that functionality that you can do an instant sync and of course an instant replication of the data. So if you add new data, it's directly sync to the replication. And the other option is of course an async. This means the application is done after a given interval. For example, every hour, every day, something like this, which is of course significantly cheaper. But of course, what you need to consider is that you have here a gap, and which I called here storage gap, which is more or less a maximum acceptable loss of data, which is defined by the interval. So the interval when you do the sync defines in the maximum acceptable loss of data which you could accept for that one. Just once again, the SDS service provides an instant sync, so there is no interval to be configured. In addition, of course, the challenge with replication is, of course, if data is modified, so if it's deleted, if it's encrypted, compromised, whatever is happening to the data is, of course, then synchronized to the other location as well, to the other storage system. So therefore, independent what happens, it's directly synchronized, which is could be, of course, an disadvantage then, because we see it now, it, of course, does mean if someone is accidental or deliberately deleting data, modifying data, then of course this is replicated to the second storage system, and that means it does not protect really against these user software related ransomware virus issues which could appear and damages, so on the logical area. But it does protect against all the physical issues which can appear and physical damage or failure which can appear to the hardware storage system itself. That's how it should be used in general. So that if hardware fails on one system in one, then on the other system it can take over and can work properly. That's what it's used for. So if we just compare, replication is of course the fastest recovery option because you have a complete copy of a system where you just, for example, then start this copy of the system, and of course it protects against any kind of hardware failure. The disadvantage, of course, you have here duplicated resources, which is, of course, quite clear because you need to replicate the data. You have it two times stored. It does not protect against any software or user-related issues, failures, or like deletion, all these items. And, of course, what is the use case? Of course, is high availability. So if you want to make sure that if hardware devices fail, and the service should be running again, then of course replication is the option to go for. Now let's come to the third topic, which is the backup service or a generic backup service. And here I would like to even go with you a little bit more in depth about how this exactly works. And here, of course, you have production data, which you're using, and you have, on the other hand, backup data. So backup means, of course, that you backup your data, you store a copy of the data inside another repository or storage system. And of course, here you can see if you add on day one data, then of course you get a copy of the data. If you add then data and you do another backup, then of course you get another copy. But of course, here the disadvantage is that the data which you have already backup is even stored here. So this is what we call a full backup. We will come to the topic of an incremental backup in a second. So, but what you should see here is already that, of course, we have here an issue with that one. If you only do full backups of data, of course, you are multiplying the data storage requirements or demands, because somehow you then store, for example, here these magenta colored data multiple times in the backup system and backup this multiple times. That's, of course, a challenge and a disadvantage of full backups. So Niels is asking a question from your experience. What is typically a time span between the time data is compromised, say by ransomware, and actually detecting by this issue? That's a very difficult question because the question is, of course, is the data critical enough? And if the data is critical enough, what are the measurements or the implementations you take to, for example, monitor this? There are, of course, systems in place which can monitor if data is encrypted and take actions against this. There's a lot of software in place or solutions in place which could, of course, review what's happening on the storage system, etc. So it's not really experience. Everything is working a little bit different. So, for example, it can even happen that the virus or the ransomware is already sitting inside the system and reviewing, for example, if, for example, another device is connected from private, for example, I know that there might be virus in place, ransomware, which are sitting there and waiting for, example, USB to plug in to detect what's happening on the system. So it depends on how it's developed, the virus, the ransomware, how intelligent it is, and of course what you implement as item to monitor what's happening on your storage system. So it's not really like there is a typical time span. It depends and it differs from ransomware to ransomware. But as already mentioned, let's get back to the topic, to full backups. The downsides is, of course, that you multiply the storage consumption. So if, for example, we have here an example where the data is, for example, here the magenta colored is 700 gigabyte, the blue one is 2 gigabyte. You see here very simple that the amount of data is multiplied here throughout the days. Because if you do one full backup every day, this means you're storing the magenta colored data 3 times now here in this scenario, which means, of course, 2,100 gigabyte or 2.1 terabyte of data is then stored, which is, of course, huge amount of data. And if you multiply this, that you maybe do it every day for the next 30 days, you see that you multiply the data amount. And here, I would like to mention the item that if, of course, the one advantage is, of course, if, for example, one backup will fail, you, of course, have other full backups in place. That's the advantage. And here to exactly address the issue about multiplying data, we have the functionality of having an incremental backup, which is more or less, I would say, a functionality which is combining the pros of snapshot technologies as well as application technology. That's what I would say here, just to give you a generic comment about this. And this means here, incremental backup means if you create new data, of course, it stores then the data and does a backup of the data. And it only does an increment and stores the increment. So if you add data to the system, like here's the blue one, then of course the next backup cycle will only backup these blue data. So you don't have, you're not multiplying your storage demands. The pro of that one is, of course, that you have smaller backup size in general. The issue with that one is, of course, here as well, the same like in snapshot, if an increment will be damaged, will fail, then of course all increments from that moment onwards will even fail. So that's a disadvantage here for the incremental backup. But in a couple of seconds, we're coming to a topic how we address this. Here, once again, the overview about incremental backup and full backup. So you see here in incremental backup, you only store one time the magenta colored and the blue and the blue one. Here in the other, if you do always a full backup, of course, you're multiplying it. Very easy. In case you're using one of the OTC backup services, then, of course, you can make use, and you might be aware of that the incremental backup is possible with all of those. And I would like to mention, and I highlighted this already, if an increment fails, I mentioned already that all further increments will even fail. In the case of using the backup service in the OTC, all data which is backupped is stored in all 3 AZs of the Open Telecom Cloud, so in all 3 availability zones. So your backup is available 3 times, then in all, 1 time in all 3 AZs. So therefore, we are addressing this issue by having this kind of setup and using the 3 AZ setup. That's what I would like to mention to you. So the disadvantages we have is using incremental backup we are covering with that kind of scenario. So backup in general, what does it protect for, of course, is it covers all the items coming from ransomware, virus, users, software, natural disasters, the hardware items. So nearly everything is covered by using backup and backup methodologies. So the question from Nikolai is, new data means only added data or deleted data? I think the item was related to that one. If you're adding here new data or deleting data. Yes, this is, of course, similar to what is done inside the snapshot technology. Of course, this is stored and this is analyzed. If you delete data, if you add data, all these items are analyzed and like on the journal, which you have seen on the snapshot, are recorded. So therefore, deleted data is, of course, here as well. Let's continue. So therefore, if we talk about backups, of course, the advantage is that you have a full copy of the data at specific point and times, of course. That's an advantage. It protects against all kind of threats. It's of course, it always depends where you store it, right? So if you store all your backups on the same system and, for example, there's a ransomware sitting and detecting, or for example, you're plugging in. I know it from personal that, for example, if you're using, for example, on private, some kind of NAS system, for example, and you have the possibility to plug in the USB stick and then, for example, make a backup into that one. Of course, a ransomware could sit inside the system, could for example, then monitor what is connected to the device, how it communicates. All these items could be monitored, and then, of course, it could even attack the USB stick and the backup to stored on the USB. So this can even be done. So therefore, it's very, very important to really plan how you, where you back up and how it's done. But this could even happen, depending, of course, of the ransomware which is sitting in the system. So let's get back to backup. So it protects against all kinds of threats. It's very flexible. As we have seen, you have the possibility, and here for all the OTC servers, you have the possibility to do an incremental backup as well as make use of the full backup. So you can implement both mechanics. And of course, incremental, as mentioned, is very good in order to avoid multiplying storage consumption and storage costs, of course. The disadvantage is, of course, it consumes most storage resources because, of course, you multiply the storage demands, you have a full copy of data, so it consumes most storage resources. And time is even a disadvantage if you use backup because it takes the longest to protect and the longest to recover. So time is here even an issue. So if you want to have really quick recovery, of course, an SDRS service would be maybe an option if, for example, you want to protect against hardware failure. If you want to protect against data deletion, of course, then snapshots. But of course, snapshots, replications, does not replace any backup. So therefore, backup is, of course, from a use case point of view, a must-have in order to recover and ensure that everything is covered. So therefore, here's an overview once again of what we have inside the OTC. So we have inside the OTC, of course, the EVS snapshots. We have the replication functionality covered within the storage disaster recovery service. And we have three kinds of backup services, as you know, volume backup service, cloud server backup service, and the cloud backup and recovery. We talked about speed, about executing an backup and, of course, restoring. Here already we have seen that, of course, snapshot is very fast in terms of execution and restoring. Replication is even fast in terms of restore. Of course, execution, it means even if you have a lot of data stored on the device, of course, these data needs to be copied to the second storage device. And in terms of backup, we already said about this is slow, slow. So therefore, time is here the issue, as already mentioned. From a protection point of view, we already covered this item as well. Snapshots, of course, is for the logical area, so for software and user-related issues, replication for the physical layer, for the hardware-related issues, and backup, of course, covers both. And therefore, backup is still a must-have use case. I mentioned snapshots, short-term protection, 3 to 5 days. For replication, the use case is quite easy. It's high availability, instant recovery, so that you can make sure that there is no outage in the service if, for example, the hardware will fail or is damaged. Then I would leave that topic talking about generic backup technologies. Now I would like to come to the cloud backup and recovery service, which is added to the Open Telecom Cloud, which is available in DE and NL, as you might be aware of. If not, then you're now aware of. And here we have the possibility, of course, to do a full and incremental backups of Elastic Cloud Server, ECS, the Elastic Volume Service. And what's coming up next is even the SFS Turbo. So it will then even support SFS Turbo backup and recovery. Here I would like to mention one item. I'm still discussing with the team when we can make the beta release. So it's mentioned on the slides that it's Q1 in 2022, but you will see this. We will make an official release note about this. I will do a blog post about the release. So you will see once we do the beta period for this functionality. What is the highlights of the cloud backup and recovery service? Of course, on the one hand, of course, I already mentioned it is able to backup the ECS server, EVS disk, and SFS turbo file shares. We have the functionality of incremental backup. I already mentioned to you what is the advantage because it minimizes storage costs. Here, of course, for failure issues, we have the backups which are stored in three AZs. I already mentioned this as well and covered this. What we have in addition here, and that's a new item which you might not be aware if you're using the CSBS or the VBS service, we have here a functionality which is called vaults. This is you are setting up a vault where you store your data. And here it's mentioned scaling with cost control. So what you have here as an option, you can define a maximum quota for this vault. This means you cannot exceed the storage or the storage demands or the storage of your backups inside these vaults, and therefore can keep control of your costs. So we had this item, of course, in some customer cases where, for example, they use CSPS service or VBS service and have not properly monitored, configured this. And of course, if you configure full backups and execute full backups, your storage can, of course, is multiplied always. So it will extremely, and if you configure vaults, you can avoid that that misconfiguration can lead, for example, to multiplying storage consumption. And then suddenly, at the end of the month, you receive the invoice, you identify, oh my God, this is more than I wanted. And with vaults, you have this kind of control mechanism where you can really define a maximum. From a licensing point of view, I would like to say you're just paying for what you're storing inside the cloud backup recovery service. So the vault and this vault size has no impact on the invoicing itself. Then you're able to create policies you might be aware of already and when you're using the other services, which ensures that you continuously create backups and of course can manage the lifecycle. So when the backup is deleted and there are various other functions like restore, create disks, image, file shares, we are coming to the topic even in a second. Here is the structure of the service. And what you already see is that of course here, it's able to backup and restore, create new services out of it. We have the cloud backup and recovery here with the policies. And what is mentioned here as well is of course the storing of data in all three AZs. This is even shown on our website. So the product website is even showing the structure. So it's easy for you to identify what it's capable of. Related to the beta of the SFS Turbo, this is planned for Q1 22. As mentioned, so we had to slightly delay this because of other priorities. And here I would like to mention that we are running these beta then for 3 months, which is a closed beta where you can apply to. We will of course inform you about how you can apply to these beta. So we are doing then a community blog post. You will get a release note on the website where you can see how to apply to the SFS Turbo and when it will be up and running. What I can already mention to you is that the usage is charged during these closed beta. That's what I would like to mention as well. The replication for data on object storage is done by Telekom, correct, Tobias? So it's automatically done. So if, for example, we are using the OBS here for storing the backup data of the cloud backup and recovery and even the other services, and the OBS is configured in that way that it always multiplies the data. So it's always done a replication to the three AZs. Let's continue with the cloud backup and recovery. And here, execution and storage. So let's first, of course, go to that one. So if you want to execute and store the backup, it's done in 4 simple steps with the cloud backup and recovery. And we're even doing a demo within a couple of minutes. So therefore, you can even see how simple it is to configure. So first of all, you select the service you would like to backup, which could be, of course, the ECS, the EVS, and later on, if the functionality is enabled, then of course the SFS Turbo. Next item is you create and configure the vault. So the vault is really where you just configure, okay, I would like to have a specific size, which is really the limit of that one where you can store. Then you define the policy. I suppose you're aware of this one when you use the other one, where you can define the execution time. So when it's done, the cycle, how often it should be done, and of course the rule when the backup should be deleted or how long it should be retained on the backup service. And last but not least, you then associate the instance, depending, of course, of what you are backupping. You're then selecting the server, the disk, or the file service. That's what you're doing. So it's done really in 4 simple steps. And in order to come back to the vault topic, that one, you really configure first the vault and define, okay, this is the vault. Should it be a vault for server backups, for disks, for SFS Turbo? That's what you do. Then the next item is, and here we have a much more sophisticated structure of configuring backups, is then you configure the backup policy, and you can configure this one. So you can, of course, configure multiple backup policies, and then, of course, configure the execution time, the cycle, the retention rule, and then apply this to the vault. What I would like to mention is that only the backup policies can, of course, be applied to multiple vaults, but only one vault can only receive one backup policy. So that's even shown here. one backup policy can be applied to multiple vaults, but the other way around, only one backup policy can be applied to one vault. I hope that this is clear with that one. And then last but not least, of course, you select the instances to connect to the vault. And so you see already that the structure is a little bit different from what you know from the VBS and the CSPS service, if you're using that one. So therefore, that's it. And of course, what you're even maybe aware of course, vaults can only store backups of one type of service and are therefore service specific. Execution time. Here I already, if you create the policy, of course, you can configure these three items, the execution time, so the time when the backup is executed on an hourly basis. So this is, of course, you can here select multiple hours. You can then configure the cycles, so how often, when it should be done, week-based or custom, which means week-based, of course, you can select which day in the week. Custom means, of course, every 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days, depending on which kind of cycle you would like to have. This is, and of course, if you would like to daily, you leave it like it is here, every 1 day. And retention rule is then, of course, how long you would like to store this. So backup quantity is, of course, then you define here, based on the FIFO principle, how many backups are stored here. And of course, you can even configure long-term retention settings that, for example, the latest backup of each day is, for example, saved on long-term, on a weekly, monthly, and yearly basis. This can even be configured with backup quantity. Then you have the time period, where you can say a backup should be available for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 1 year. And of course, you can custom with a custom configuration here. And permanent means, of course, that you permanently store this. And then you, of course, need to manually get rid of the backup if you would like to delete it. Backup execution when using a policy. So here, I would like to mention then, if you're setting up a policy, then of course, it's automatically using and making a full backup of the existing storage system, of the existing server, whatever you are backing up, and is doing a full backup. And afterwards, incremental backups are performed. So if you use a backup policy, please keep in mind, this means one time, the first time a full backup is done, and from that moment onwards, it's incremental backups. You can, of course, manually do a new full backup if it's necessary and mandatory for you. This, of course, depends on your requirements. But I would like to mention that this is done. From an encryption point of view, there is no default encryption for backups. So if the volume or the source is encrypted, then the backup will be encrypted as well. What I would like to mention here as well is there's a functionality that you can share backups. We will come to the topic in a second. What I would like to mention here is that sharing of encrypted backups is not possible. You cannot share this with other projects or other domains inside the OTC. Operations, what can you do with the backups? And first of all, you can, of course, create vault operations because you execute these directly on the vault, and we will see this in a couple of seconds then. And this is, you can directly perform a backup. So if you are inside the vault, you can, even if a policy is applied, you can directly perform a backup. Of course, what you can do as well is you can, of course, expand the capacity of the vault. So if you need more, you just simply expand it. You can, of course, delete the vault. You can apply the backup policy to that vault. And what you can even configure is that you associate the specific service or server, the disk, SFS Turbo file service, and you have the functionality to automatic associate services. So this means then that, of course, if you create a new ACS server, that, for example, this automatically goes into the backup. Backup operations means, of course, when the backup is done and these backups are stored there inside the service, and of course, as mentioned, it's stored here inside the OBS, that you can do operations. And here you can, for example, share or unshare your backups with other tenants, domains, or projects inside the OTC. You can delete the backup. And of course, you can create based on your backup. You can create, for example, for ECS server creation, you can create an image. You can, for example, create out of the service, you can create an EVS disk. Or for the file service, you can create even a new SFS Turbo file service for that one. And here I would like to mention even that there will be a limitation for the SFS Turbo that you cannot directly restore the service. You need to create a new file server here in order to make a restore. Or for restore purposes. I just want to mention already. Therefore, we are coming to recovery, and here it's even mentioned. Recovery, of course, means I would like to do a restore of the service, which you can do with the service for the CBR. And an important note is if we make the SFS Turbo available, the restore cannot be directly done on the file service. You need to create then based on the backup a new file service access to the file service then. But this will even be informed to you then when we do the release, and this will be visible to you in nearly every materials on the product page, etc. This will be visible to you. So you can clearly identify that that's an item and a limitation. So service interdependencies. So what's the service is interacting with? Of course, main service relations is of course the ECS. It's creating a backup recovery for ECS, EVS, and SFS Turbo. For of course, it has a relation to IMS because you can create the image. Support service relations, of course, the EM. You have default rules for CBR. And of course, it's able to record the log. So if you do a backup, of course, it's logged inside the CTS service. So we're coming now to a live demonstration of the cloud backup. I just click that to check that everything is still up and running. Yes, I'm not disconnected. So here inside the OTC console, so we have here the cloud backup and recovery service. And if you would like to start creating a backup, of course, you click on the cloud backup and recovery service. So here you see on the left side, you see already what I mentioned with the first step, selecting what you would like to backup. So you can select here then cloud server backups, cloud disk backups. And of course, the third option, if then enabled, will be then the SFS Turbo backups. And you already see here that there's a different kind of structure because you see here that you have here the point policies. And tasks is, of course, something like a log file where you can see what has been operated on the CBR service. So you can see what's done. If it was successful, for example, I deleted just before today, this morning, I deleted one of the vaults because it was already a demo vault. So I deleted this, for example, and I see here it was successful. Everything worked fine. Then if I would like to create a new backup, I go here to cloud server backups. And you see here already an vault existing. But I can, of course, create a new vault. So here on the top right corner, I see here plus create server backup vault. I click on this and start here creating a new vault. What I can do here is I, of course, can here then select the associated server. So first of all, I can select what I would like to backup. I think that are already inside backups, even though they are stopped. Just for demo purpose, I select these two here. I can here define, for example, the vault capacity. So here is, of course, mentioned that the backup task will fail if the vault is exceeded. Here, one item which I maybe should mention. So if, for example, the backup has not reached the limit right now, and the new backup cycle is running, it will not stop within the backup cycle. So if it hits the limit of, for example, 20 gigabyte, so if you make the limit of 20 gigabyte and the vault is currently as 19 gigabyte and it would go to maybe 21 gigabyte with the backup, it will do and execute the backup. So it will not stop at 20 gigabytes. So the backup will be done, even if it's 21 gigabyte or 25 gigabyte or even 30 gigabyte, the backup will be executed. That I would like to mention. So the backup task will only not be executed once the limit has already been exceeded. Just to give you that information here inside the session, because I think it's a very important. Then we are able to configure here the auto backup means, of course, a policy. So I can say I don't want to set a policy and just do one time a backup, but of course, policies make sense. So I can create here one of the policies created or even start here creating a new one. So I will maybe do this one here, of course, give it a proper naming. You see, then you can see here, even if you just make a mouse over, that you can see what is configured here inside that one. But even if we go to create policy, you see here that I can directly out of the service create a new policy. And this is what I already have shown to you. I can create here a new policy. Of course, I could provide it a proper name, but I'm not doing it right now. So I can select here the timings when I would like to do this. So for example, no one is working at 3 in the night. So I could do it every day. And here I can configure, for example, I do it every day, but not Saturday and Sunday because we close Saturday and Sunday. So no one is really storing data, existing data and using the service, maybe. Here I of course can select in the custom cycle where I said, okay, you can define in which kind of cycle it will do an backup. So this means, of course, every 5 days now. So it's not, there's no relation towards the weekdays. It's just every 5 days a backup is done. If I would every day, of course, and every day on 3 o'clock, it will be gone. So that's the logic behind. And if I do it week-based, of course, I can select here Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So always on these days, 3 o'clock in the morning, the backup is executed. Here, the retention rule, of course, defines, as already mentioned, how long the backup is stored. So I can define it by backup quantity. So 90 backups is stored. I can say, okay, only 2 backups. So depending on how many backups I would like to have, this is, and here's the long-term configuration, which I can configure that I would like to maybe have long-term retention on the backups. Then I can say, for example, I would like every week 1 long-term backup retained. So that's what I can configure here. And time period, of course, is based on time. So I say the backup will be made available for 1 month, 3 months. And I said already custom, where you can configure then on a daily basis. And you can say, okay, I would like to have it maybe for 200 days, whatever you would like to configure here. So you can really in-depth configure how long the backup should be made available inside the system. And if it exceeds this 200 days, of course, then it's deleted. Or if I would like to just do permanent backups. But of course, this means a lot of storage consumption, because backups are not deleted afterwards. So that's it for the backup policy. Now I just select here for simplification, I just select here one. Here I can say, okay, I would like to have an automatic association of ECS server, for example, when I create a new one, that it's added to that one. So, and if I don't want to have it, if I want to manually do it, I can just skip this option. Of course, text is of course an item. Here I can give it a name. Oops. And then I say create now. Submit. And now it's creating my backup. That's it. You see it's very easy, and the user interface is very user friendly. So you see it's very easy. Once done, you see afterwards if the vault is now enabled here. I gave it the same name. I think that's that one here. Okay. You see that I can here, of course, perform the actions, which I already mentioned. So you can here associate further servers. You can here directly perform a backup. You can here apply the backup policy again, expand the capacity. So you have here the options, which I already mentioned. Very easy to use inside the vault. But you can already see that there's a difference between vaults, and here are the backups. So what I see here, here are the backup files, where I can then, of course, have the operations on backups, where I can then say, okay, here's, for example, an auto backup, where I can restore directly the server, create the image, or share the backup. That's for the options which I already mentioned. So same, of course, here available then for cloud disk backups, and you see similar options then for the SFS Turbo. Here, for example, I haven't created one, but here you can see the user interface is the same. So, but here, of course, I can see then the disks available for the servers. So, but it's the same user interface, the same functionality, it works the same way. And if you're aware about configuring the CSBS or configuring the VBS, of course, you see that it's much more convenient to work here, because you can create a vault, connect the servers and all the disks to these vaults. So you have a better overview about what you're backing up, how you configure it. So therefore, I think it's a better structured service, in my opinion. But that's personal opinion. So that's it for the live demo. Let's continue, because we have some more. Is the service also supported via API, SDK, and ELC tools? Yes, it's supported via those tools. Please look at the documentation, because I'm not able to cover now all the specifications for API, etc. But it's even supported here for the tools. So let's get back to the backup portfolio. As already mentioned, we have the CBR, which is a new service. We have the CSBS and VBS service, which are handling CSBS only the ECS server and VBS only EVS disks. That's what I already mentioned. So you have here with the CBR, you have 3-in-1. Of course, in short, keep in mind, scalable file service will come and we will inform you. And what here's a comparison, how we can structure the data, what is the backup, the backup data and the complete structure of the service. What you have here in the CBR is the vault mechanism. So you can create a vault for specific services. So the overview about what is backup is a little bit better, in my opinion. So, and vaults are, of course, structured by service types. You click on the left bar, you have seen the service type, then you see the list of vaults, and then you can apply, of course, the policy. So you have a better overview about what you have exactly configured to execute backups. Then you have the CSBS and the VBS, where you have one repository for all backups. There is no kind of vault concept behind, where it's a little bit more difficult from my point of view to identify how you configure this and how it's configured exactly. Then I would like to go into an overview where you see a little bit of some kind of items from functionality point of view. So if you, for example, configure the backup policies, here I mentioned I would like to list to you the differences. So for example, you can on the VBS, for example, the custom configuration of the backup cycle is only 1 to 14 days, where you have here on the CBR 1 to 30 and on the CSBS 1 to 30 days. You have the backup quantity. So the backup quantity is stored, where you can configure, for example, that after 14 backups, then the 15th backup goes out or the first goes out again. You have here the possibility only to configure 2 to 14, where you have here the configuration 2 to 99,999. So, and the optional long-term, which is not in-depth configurable for example, the VBS. So you see here's already some functional differences where the CBRs with the CBS together the most advanced one. In addition, we have here another overview where you can see the CBR, CSBS, and VBS once again. I already mentioned the services which are backup. You have automatic source associations, so you can automatically add then sources. So the service is adding the sources. If new server is created, it's automatically added to, for example, the CBR service. You can share, for example, here, what is not given inside the CSBS, you cannot share the backup for created for ECS servers created by CSBS. You cannot share this. In CBR, you have this sharing functionality. Of course, you can delete backup and you can restore here. So here as well, the CBR is the most advanced one. Kim is asking, is it planned to restore the SFS also without an create operation? Yes, we are working on this topic. So this is, of course, planned. I cannot give you a timeline when it will be available, because currently we will start with a beta version of that one, where you cannot directly restore. But we will, of course, continuously work on that item. But I cannot give you now an overview when. Because first of all, we would like to make it now available as a beta. Of course, beta is not really a beta service. It has a full functionality, which is even planned for the go live then. So it's not really a beta, I would say. But we would like to have a few customers using it, testing it, giving us feedback before then giving it to everyone and then receiving the feedback of everyone. But of course, we are even playing around with the service making sure that the service is reliably working, that everything is working fine. So currently we are doing some UI modifications. So we're doing some modifications in the user interface of the FSS Turbo backup in order to improve it slightly. That's the item which we are executing. Then we're coming to the roadmap, the backup functionality as beta to Q1 2022. And for Q2, of course, we're planning then to release the functionality for every customer. So there's no one that needs to apply for that functionality any longer. In Q1, we will even provide fine-grained policies for the CBR functionality, which is even, as you might know, not given for CSBS as well as VBS, so that you can granularly define access rights via IAM. We will implement here the CES monitoring and alarming into the CBR functionality that you, for example, get alarms once, for example, a backup will fail, once the vault will exceed the size, all these items that you can configure. And midterm that you have application consistent backup, which, for example, is necessary in terms of if you're running, for example, an SAP system. VBS and CSBS, of course, it's continuously maintained. You get continuously support for that one, but we don't plan any big feature enhancement for that one. So we are focusing here on the CBR functionality and the CBR service, because you already see that it has the most functionalities inside the service. It supports all services that you have. So the plan here is really to focus on the CBR service and enhance the CBR service. So, but of course, we're continuously maintaining and supporting that one. So if you're using VBS, if you're using CSBS, we're not planning to put it end of life, end of sale, something that this is currently not planned. But of course, maybe if we talk in 1 year, then maybe there is something. But we will give you enough time. If we maybe put this end of life, end of sales, we would give you enough time to then convert, of course, to CBR. That's for sure. From a roadmap point of view, one item, of course, the closer we are from a roadmap point of view, the more reliable. We have not too many items here inside the services. So I would always say the next two quarters are always very reliable. Where if you go to the third, fourth quarter, of course, it's less reliable because we are working agile. So items can change. That's the reason why I would like to just mention this, that it could change. But here, this is more or less very reliable. So you can expect that this is released within Q1. And for sure, SFS Turbo will be. Here's a comprehensive overview about of the service differences. So you can read it on your own. You see here that CBR has most functionalities, most supported services. From my point of view, the best user experience. You have the most advanced configuration and backup policies, the most feature set. And of course, when it comes to product improvements that are even given inside the CBR service. So if you have not tested CBR right now, if you're not aware that this is even available, please take a look at this one. Play around with that service, and I hope that you will like it. And if you have any feedback, of course, you're always free to give us feedback to that one, what we can improve, what can be done better. If something is not easy to understand, let us know that. So if you have other questions, you can always reach me by mobile or by email. You can even write me an email. So, and of course, you can even post your questions inside the OTC community. Some of you have already seen that I'm very responsive there. So if there's a questions, normally I get an automatic notification and I respond very quick to the questions raised. So then if there are no further questions, I would like to say thank you and hand over back to maybe Stefan, who wants to say some words.
Perfect. Thank you a lot, Daniel, for this great webinar we had today here together with you. So thank you for joining and bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.